So, because of her testimony from another witness, it's about 50% of the cost of the tobacco tax is normally what is necessary to cover the healthcare related costs. In other words, in Arkansas's case, it'd be $50 to $80 million. That's all we have in Arkansas. And I go, there's a lot of difference between $50 to $80 million and over $1 billion.
Yes, sir. I would like to know their source of information. We're very comfortable in what we have worked together and what we have received from the Center for Disease Control in regards to our statistics here.
So specifically the Medicaid costs. I mean, how do we know that when somebody gets lung cancer that it was, are we coding those somehow that we can track that these are associated with a cigarette?
That information also comes from CDC through their evaluation of our Medicaid costs that we have. I'll be able to cite, I'll get the specific cite for you and we'll share it with you before the end of this meeting.
Okay, and then I don't know whether you or one of the guys from DFNA that mentioned this Oklahoma, that they're getting ready to increase theirs $1 a pack, so then we'll be lower than Oklahoma, significantly lower than Texas. I guess, what is Oklahoma doing with that revenue? Does anybody know why? What was the legislative effort?
I'd be more than happy to share. Initially, they had a $1.50 tobacco fee that was found to be unconstitutional 2 years ago. When they reconvened in special session, the $1.50 tobacco fee was proposed by Governor Powell for some of the specific public health needs that they have in the state of Oklahoma. When it was found to be unconstitutional, there was not an agreement for $1.50, but rather there was an agreement to levy a series of taxes, including a dollar tobacco tax, primarily to deal with their budget crisis, and in addition to fund teacher salaries, an increase in teacher salaries.
So it's not going for tax reduction elsewhere, it's going to fix budget holes?
Yes.
Thank you.
Representative Dawson, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This may or it may not be a question the DFNA can answer, but as far as since our tax rate on cigarettes is higher than almost all of the rest of the surrounding states, have we seen any bleed over in, I guess, smuggling was the use of the word last week. In the enforcement of, or have we been going in when we're trying to collect taxes and that sort of thing and seeing tax stamps from other states currently?
Representative Dawson, certainly we do see from time to time audits that have been performed of taxpayers where they had in their inventory cigarettes from other states. I do know that tobacco control also is involved with the enforcement of Arkansas's laws. I can certainly check with Tobacco Control and maybe get some additional information on that particular subject as to what their efforts are and number of cases for prosecution. We'll see what information we can provide to you on that subject.
Excellent. And as you're checking into that, I know that we increased that tobacco tax half a dozen years ago, 8 years ago, something like that.
2009.
If you could check with them and see if there's an increase in the number of cases from before that to after that most recent change made.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Representative Kavanaugh, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is for Cancer Society. Missouri has a much lower rate than Arkansas does on their cigarette products. What is their rate of smoking and their statistics in smoking as it compares to Arkansas?
That's a great question. Let me see if I have those statistics with me. My memory is not as great as I think maybe it was close. The state of Missouri currently has an adult smoking rate of 22.1%, slightly lower than the state of Arkansas, a pregnancy smoking rate of 16.7%, equivalent to Arkansas, a youth smoking rate of 11%, less than Arkansas.
Then the theory that we have of higher taxes on cigarettes doesn't play out with Missouri.
Well,
what is that fact? I mean, why is that different than the other statistics?
It's a great question. And I would suggest to you that it is a different market. It is one that is different in socioeconomics and different demographics in the state of Arkansas. And because of that, I think that that's why you have smoking rates that are different slightly in the state of Missouri than they are in the state of Arkansas. Again, those differences are not nearly as great. I mean, you know, just again, to quote specifically what we have here in Arkansas, I want to make sure I'm accurate in this. They're 22.1, we're at 23.6. We have 15% of the pregnant women in our state that currently smoke, as compared to Missouri that has 16.7. They have a youth smoking rate of 11%. We're at 15.7. Again, I am not familiar with all of their mechanisms on how they enforce their smoking and tobacco specific regulations. I am not familiar with all of the areas that have other regulations that limit smoking. I know that they have some communities that have implemented tobacco 21. I know that they have some that have a more comprehensive smoke-free laws than we have here in the state of Arkansas. So from a regulatory perspective, I think it's different, as well as from a demographic perspective.
Okay, thank you.
Senator Wallace, you recognize me.
So if we were able to be
well, what you got?
Now that
all right.
If we were able to reduce the percentage of folks that are smokers by 5% in the state of Arkansas, we should see a 5% corresponding reduction in.
It would be one that would lag. Simply because of the fact of the numbers that start, the numbers that currently smoke quit, those that that sometimes quit and then they start again. Statistics show it takes 6 or 7 efforts for someone on average to quit. Some folks are able to quit cold turkey, others are not. But generally over a period of time, you would see, as you see an improvement in that smoking rate, you would begin to see a reduction in the incidence of lung cancer, a reduction in the incidence of death by lung cancer, and other statistics would begin to fall.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. C80, Representative Hammer, you recognize.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I was curious if you have the numbers, or you can give them to me offline if you got them, as far as the cost per person to the Medicaid system in Missouri, where the cost of cigarette tax is less to the cost to the Medicaid system in Arkansas, where the tax is higher.
Representative Hammer, I do not have those statistics, but I'll be more than happy to get them.
All right. And then secondly, in your numbers that you're presenting, do you factor out those that are covered by private insurance, and do you segregate them and have any statistics as far as how much it costs them in increased private insurance rates?
That's an excellent question. I'll do some additional research and get those numbers for you as well. I do not have those here with me.
Okay, I'd like to get those real time. Thank you, Chair.
All right, seeing no more questions. Do you have anything else you want to add?
No, Mr. Chair.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Kent. Appreciate your input. All right. We have a motion on proposal 4 and 5.
I know one of these was Senator Irvin's, and I think the other one was Senator Wallace. So I move that I'd be able to work with them, the GLR staff, to further refine item 5. Consideration.
Have a motion. We have a second.
I second.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye. Any opposed? You have it. That's mighty weak. All right. We're going to go to items proposal 6, 7, and 8, alcohol beverages. Mr. Leonard, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Proposal number
six would convert the taxes on alcoholic beverages to a percentage of the purchase price rather than a tax based on volume. This proposal is intended to be revenue neutral at the point of the change in the law. DFNA stated that they're unable to provide this with impact on this proposal because they don't have available the average wholesale cost by which they can make those calculations. You can see there Arkansas currently levies taxes on alcohol beverages at the following rates. Beer at $7.50 per barrel, wine 75 cents per gallon, red wine 25 cents per gallon, liquor at $2.50 per gallon, malt liquor 20 cents per gallon, pre-mixed liquor $1 per gallon, light liquor 50 cents per gallon, and then mixed drinks at 14% of the gross receipts. So you can tell that our taxes are generally volume based. However, we also levy a 1% special excise tax on beer and a 3% special excise tax on liquor, cordial, liqueurs, specialties, and sparkling and still wines. Most of the revenues from alcoholic beverages are general revenues. However, the additional 4% mixed drink tax is special revenue that goes to the University of Arkansas Medical Center Fund. The first alcoholic beverage tax we had was in 1933, and that was a tax of $1 per barrel of beer. In 1935, the state imposed taxes on liquor and wine, 40 cents per gallon for liquor and 10 cents per gallon for wine, and then 3 cents per gallon on malt liquor. In 1951, the state levied the 3% tax on the liquor, cordials, liqueurs, specialties, and sparkling and still wine. And then in 1969, the state enacted the mixed drink tax for on-premise consumption. In 2001, we created an additional special excise tax of 3% on beer that expired in 2007. So in 2007, levied an additional excise tax of 1% on beer. That's the 1% tax that exists today. And then last year, we extended the $7.50 per barrel tax on beer to include hard cider. Under proposal number 7, this would increase the excise tax on wine and beer by 20%. So the resulting tax rates would be $9 per barrel on beer, 90 cents per gallon on wine, and 30 cents per gallon on light wine. DFNA has indicated that this would have a total fiscal impact of $3,008,000. And if the native brewery tax rebate is extended, then that amount would increase annually from $255,000 to $305,000. Again, you have our current rates for beer and wine, plus the 1% special tax on beer and 3% special tax on wine. The history of this is the same as the proposal number 6. However, this proposal does raise some potential Amendment 19 issues because the per barrel beer tax is generally considered to fall under the Amendment 19 requirements because it was enacted in 1933. So this proposal would require an emergency clause and a 3/4 vote because of that. And then proposal number 8 is slightly different. This one would be to create a separate excise tax, about 2.5% on the retail sale of cigarettes, other tobacco products, e-cigarettes, and all of the alcoholic beverages. And DFNA has indicated that they are not able to provide a full fiscal impact on this because they don't have any access to all the necessary information, in particular the information related to retail sales. So with the current cigarette tax being a per cigarette tax, they don't have access to the amount that the wholesaler or producer charges to a retailer for cigarettes. On tobacco products other than cigarettes, they've estimated that this proposal would have an impact of approximately $2.1 million in additional revenue. But again, they don't have the information on the retail price to evaluate this as a retail tax. With regard to e-cigarettes, based on the previous impacts, they've stated that this would generate approximately $450,000 in additional revenue. Again, have the issue with not having information available regarding the retail price. And based on the beverage excise tax, beer excise tax, and mixed drink tax revenues, this proposal would result in additional $13.4 million on those beverages, but that does not include beer and wine sold by entities that have an ABC permit because those are taxed under the sales tax and not reported separately. So overall, according to DFNA, this would have a total fiscal impact of $15,950,000, not including the retail aspect of certain components, and it would exclude cigarettes. Arkansas currently levies a tax on the first sale of tobacco products in the state at the rates that you can see on page 2. Cigarettes, again, are $1.15 per pack. Cigars are 68% of the manufacturer's invoice price, but it's as a maximum tax of 50 cents per cigar. Other tobacco products are taxed at 68% of the manufacturer's invoice price, and then cigarette papers are 25 cents per package of 32 sheets. Arkansas does not levy a tax on e-cigarettes. Again, most of the revenue from tax on cigarettes and other tobacco products are general revenues, and the special are the same as we talked about in proposal number 4. With respect to alcoholic beverages, the rates are the same as we just discussed with proposal number 6. In terms of the history of the cigarette and tobacco product taxes, in addition to what we talked about with proposal number 4, in 1929, the state levied a 10% tax on the selling price of cigars. That was the same act that levied the tax on cigarettes. In 1969, we created the Tobacco Products Tax Act, which levied a tax of 15% on the wholesale selling price of tobacco products, not including cigars, snuff, cigarettes, and little cigars. The history for the alcoholic beverage law is the same as under proposal number 6. With respect to Amendment 19, this one requires a little bit of a different analysis. As we talked about before, the tax on cigarettes and cigars and then the per barrel beer tax fall under Amendment 19. But Amendment 19 applies only to the specific rate, if the specific rates of tax are being increased. If it's a new tax that's being created, then it wouldn't be subject to Amendment 19. In determining whether something is a new tax or an extension of an existing tax, courts consider various factors, including what product is actually being taxed, who's bearing the burden of paying the tax, how the tax is structured, and then what the funds that are generated by the tax are being used for. The Attorney General, of course, have indicated that who bears the burden of paying the tax is one of the more important considerations. So this proposal is intended to create a separate tax that would be structured as a new tax rather than an extension of the existing taxes. It's similar to the existing taxes and that it would be levied on the same products, and the revenues would likely be general revenues like most of the revenues from the existing taxes. But it would be different in that it would be structured as a percentage tax based on the retail price and collected by the retailer. It's unclear whether a court would determine that this proposal would fall under the Amendment 19 requirements and require an emergency clause and a 3/4 vote. But I'll note that in 2003, the Attorney General issued an opinion that a retail sales tax on tobacco products, including cigars, which falls under Amendment 19, required only a majority vote because it was a new tax, because it was a retail tax. And then the 1% excise tax on beer, which is also subject to Amendment 19, in 2007 passed with a simple majority vote and no emergency clause. And that is it for 6, 7, and 8.
Got a question. Representative Johnson, you're recognized. When you talked about the total revenue dollars, it didn't include, what did it include? The,
on number 8?
Yeah, well, you said something like $15 million, but there was part missing that wasn't in that.
Right, that's the retail aspect of some of those products, and then also cigarettes, and I think David can probably explain that a bit more.
Okay, and I wasn't looking at, when I made this proposal, you know, I was looking at several things. One, I would like to have less smokers in Arkansas, okay, and overall health increase, but instead of a flat tax on a bottle of gallon of wine or a barrel of wine or 100, you know, however it is, you know, based on the more expensive alcohol product you bought, the more tax you're going to pay. And that was, you know, my thoughts is I can buy the generic cigarettes and not pay as much tax if I buy Marlboros or whatever. So that's what I was looking at this way. I mean, we're looking at a 2.5 cents, but I was only looking for retail sales and not at restaurants that are already charging, you know, mixed drinks tax and beer tax, and I was just looking at more of a, kind of like the short-term tax rate sort of thing works, that sort of thing, on a retail sale sort of thing. So we've come up with looking at 2.5 cents. Is that what you're saying?
In making an evaluation on that fiscal impact, One of the difficulties is DFA doesn't always have the retail cost per item, such as cigarettes, if they're reported in the sales tax numbers. So we can't apply that 2.5% as easily. And additionally, that goes to some of those issues on trying to differentiate a tax on just a package store sale of a bottle of liquor or a gallon of beer, a keg of beer versus the restaurant. And so that approximately $16 million is based on the numbers we have and was referred to us when we were looking at some of those related issues. We have not evaluated questions regarding a separate tax just on package store sales of alcohol versus restaurant sales.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Senator Teague, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple observations. One being that E6, as we go through this process, they probably ought to be counted as tobacco. We ought to make them the same as tobacco for health reasons and not other reasons. Just observation here. We haven't done that, and it probably needs to happen. And I recall, you know, I've been around here since 1927, I think, and I recall maybe my first term in the Senate, we talked about raising the tax on liquor. Maybe we did a little bit, but I recall I became close friends with several bar owners during that time because they were determined to convince me that they didn't make any money on that. And I saw lots of numbers that showed that they didn't make any money, and I never believed really any of them. So just a point that there's not always as much fad in some of that stuff as we think there is. As we move forward, I'm all for getting these centers, but let's think about it if we do that. Thank you. Wouldn't you agree, sir?
Senator Henry, you're right.
Yes, Joy, I just want to clarify, I made a couple notes here. 6, 7, 8. 6, really unable to determine or no fiscal impact. And I think, again, the purpose of that one was that we're going to do an equivalent transition from volume-based taxes to sales price-based taxes.
Yes, sir.
So, and the idea being that, and I want to clarify this. So if somebody, and the example was given at our last meeting, somebody goes to the store and buys a $200 bottle of wine versus somebody who goes and buys a 25 box of wine. They're getting the same volume, so they're going to pay the same basic excise tax. But they're going to pay a different sales tax, because there's also a sales tax on that applied as well, right?
Yes.
So the only question on item 6 is, do we put the same sort of progressivity in it that we do on sales tax? So that if you're buying more expensive, the excise tax is progressive, just like the sales tax is.
That's my understanding, yes.
Okay. Item 7 and number 8, one's a 20% increase just on beer and wine. The other is a 2.5% increase on alcohol, cigarettes, tobacco products. Did that include e-cigarettes?
Yes, sir.
And that one is about $16 million, and the first one's about a $3.08 million, right? I think that's what I wrote down.
That's correct.
Okay, I just want to show you, and I think, again, for the members, there's two or three different things there. They're related as far as products go. One of them has no fiscal impact, one of them has $3 million, one of them has $16 million.